Thank you very much for a kind introduction. So this is actually a very basic introduction to rigid supersymmetry. And I assume that among you there are people who have never heard about supersymmetry, so I will start from the very beginning, motivations, blah, blah. So as you can may have seen in the on the web page, the main points of the program will be the following. So I will start with some physical motivations why we want to look for supersymmetry. Supersymmetry will be always Susie in my lectures. And in particular, I will be focused on n equal to 1 supersymmetry, which is the basic in 4 dimensions. Then we will introduce in a more formal way supersymmetry algebra, the main physical and mathematical consequences of this algebra, going through Coleman-Mandula-Nogo theorem, blah, blah. Then we will study n equal 1 Susi representations, and in particular representations realized on fields, because at the end of the day what we want to do is to construct a relativistic field theory which has supersymmetry invariants. So in particular representations realized on fields. We will have a brief look to the n-extended cases, in particular, still working in 4 dimensions. We will be interested in n equal to 2, n equal to 4 cases. Okay, then going back to n equal to 1, I will describe you how to introduce the language of superspace. And if I have time, I will show you some very simple calculation in superspace. Okay, then in particular concerning Wezzumino model. And finally, I will open the big topic of supersymmetric gauge theories. Still n equal to 1 first, abelian and non-abelian. Then extended Susi gauge theories. In particular, for this large class of theories, we will study what people call a non-renormalization theorems. It's not, of course, we will not have time to go through the actual calculations, but I will mention few main results concerning quantum properties of these theories, and in particular, non-renormalization theorems. And few consequences of these non-renormalization theories. In particular, I will mention the finiteness of n equal to 4 superyamins. And finally, I will just give you a brief idea of spontaneous breaking of supersymmetry. Okay, it's a lot of stuff for just 16 hours. therefore, well, let's see how it goes, but my idea is to leave you a lot of checks and calculations to do. Okay, so if you manage to do it and we avoid doing all calculations during the lectures, I think we will manage to cover all these topics. Okay, for the references, so bibliography, there are really a huge number of books and review, in particular reviews, that you can find in the archive. What I used are basically Sonius, but you can find the actual references on the web page. I put all the, I mean, the way you can check for this review. This is a review. I used, this is a book instead, Turning book. Then there are other nice reviews, like the one by Bilal. Aguirre's. And blah, blah. Yeah, these are basically the main references I'm going to use, but you can certainly use any other reference. The main, as you we will realize soon, the main problem, the main difficulties working with the supersymmetry are spinors, fermions, of course, spinorial fields, and therefore conventions for spinorial fields. So any reference you use, for sure, it will use a different convention from all the others that you have used so far. Therefore, the main problem is really to match convention. I'm not even sure that I will follow the same convention for the whole lectures, but we'll try. Okay, so let me start with a very few prerequisites. In fact, as I was mentioning, the main point working with supersymmetry is that we have spinors in the game. Therefore, we have to fix a few conventions about spinors. I assume that all of you know quantum field theory, basics of quantum field theory, ordinary non-supersymmetric quantum field theories, gauge theories, okay. Group theory, I guess everybody knows. So let me just... mention the main conventions that we will use that dealing with fermions. And these are necessary, of course, when you want to do some explicit checks of what I will tell you. Okay, so first of all, as I said, we will always work in four dimensions. I'm sorry, but I don't think I will have time to do anything for supersymmetric theories in different dimensions. So we will work in four dimensions, Minkowski, four-dimensional space-time, with matrix given by 1, minus 1, minus 1, blah, blah. We know that in Minkowski four dimensions, we have Vi spinors. Belonging to representation 1/2 0 of Lorentz group. Or 0/1/2. Okay, by spinors belonging to 1/2 0 is what we call left-handed spinors. And 0/1/2 is what we call right-handed spinors. They are two-component spinors. And in particular, we will use the following notation. For a left by spinors, we will use psi alpha, alpha equal to 1 and 2. And for right by spinor, we will use chi bar alpha dot with alpha dot equal 1 dot and 2 dot out of 2 Y spinors left and right. We can build up a Dirac spinor. This belongs to representation 1/2 0 plus 0 1/2, and the most general Dirac spinor will be a 4-component object that we will write this way. Okay. How do we realize Clifford algebra on these spinors? Since it's certainly better using Weyl spinors when we work with supersymmetry, we will use a Weyl basis for gamma matrices. Which amounts to choose gamma mu given by a 2/2 0 here, sigma mu, sigma bar mu, and 0. Where sigma mu, by definition, is mu is going, of course, 0, 1, 2, 3. So gamma zero is the identity, sigma zero is the identity, and for I equal to 1, 2, and 3, gamma mu is given by Pauli matrices, and sigma bar mu is instead the identity and minus sigma I, Pauli matrices satisfying, as you know, sigma I sigma j equal to delta I j plus I epsilon I j k sigma k. This is the basic property that we are going to use. How do we think of gamma mu acting on a Dirac spinor? So how we deal with spinorial indices. So when you write gamma mu applied to psi, this by definition for me is a sigma mu alpha alpha dot sigma bar mu alpha dot alpha applied to psi alpha chi bar alpha dot. Okay, which gives you as a first component sigma mu alpha alpha dot psi alpha, the opposite, alpha alpha dot chi bar alpha dot, and sigma bar mu alpha dot alpha psi alpha. Okay, in particular, we will always use the rule that alpha indices, when contracted, go from up, down, this direction, while alpha dot indices, when they are contracted, go in this direction, down, up. This is important because, you know, as we will see in a moment, if you change the rule, you will get minus signs floating around, okay? And in fact, whenever I write, for instance, so let's say convention, whenever I write the product of two spinors, two left-handed spinors in this way, by definition, this means contracting the alpha indices this way, and similarly, when we write epsilon bar psi bar, by definition, this is the opposite direction. This is basically the convention that you can find in Turning, for instance, and Sonius, but not all the review and books that you can find in the market use the same conventions, of course. But let's try to do everything consistent with this convention. Okay, since alpha basically labels an SL to C representation, we can use the antisymmetric epsilon tensor in order to rise and lower spinorial indices. So rising and lowering spinorial indices. We use epsilon alpha beta equal to 0 - 1 - 1 - 0, which means epsilon 1 - 2 equal to -1, and epsilon alpha beta equal to 0 - 1 - 1 - 0. This is also something that is certainly very conventional. I mean, something that you can change. I mean, so you will never find exactly the same convention in any book. We use this convention because we want to use the following identity and the same for epsilon alpha dot beta dot. So we will write, epsilon alpha dot beta dot still equal to 0 - 1 - 1 - 0. Epsilon alpha dot beta dot the opposite, in such a way that epsilon alpha dot beta dot times epsilon beta dot gamma dot is equal to delta alpha dot gamma dot. How do we rise and lower indices? This is also convention. So our convention will be the following. Psi components with lower indices by definition is epsilon alpha beta. Well, let's do the opposite, sorry. This is the beginning, so psi alpha. This is epsilon alpha beta psi beta. And given this convention of epsilon, you can invert this relation and write that psi beta is equal to epsilon beta alpha psi alpha. And of course, the same thing for alpha dot. So chi bar alpha dot, this is epsilon alpha dot beta dot chi bar beta dot, but you can even have this if you invert. Okay, so for instance, if you take psi 1 up, this is equal to epsilon 1 2 psi 2 down, so this is equal to psi 2. Psi 1 up is equal to psi 2 down, and so on and so forth. Okay, starting from these identities and these definitions, you can check that the following identities follow. So we have, for instance, that if you write chi alpha psi alpha, this is equal to minus chi alpha psi alpha. Check it. So that's why I was telling you just a few minutes ago that we have to decide which is our convention to sum in spinorial indices, otherwise we may have sign mistakes floating around, okay? And the same, if we have chi bar alpha dot psi bar alpha dot, this is equal to minus chi bar alpha dot psi bar alpha dot. And as a second, this is one point, as a second point, we always have that chi psi And if I do not indicate indices, means the our standard convention up down, this is equal to psi chi, still up down. Okay. Another set of very useful identities concern sigma mu and sigma bar mu matrices. So property identities, useful identities. For sigma mu, sigma bar mu. That we better keep in mind. The first one is the following. We have sigma mu alpha alpha dot sigma bar mu beta dot beta. This is equal to twice delta alpha beta delta alpha dot beta dot. Try and check. Okay, then we have another set of important identities with basically imply Clifford algebra for gamma mu. And this can be written in the following way. If you have sigma mu, sigma bar mu, plus sigma mu, sigma bar mu, this is equal to twice eta mu nu. Then I will tell you how this identity has to be understood. This has to be understood the following way. If we put indices, this means sigma mu alpha alpha dot sigma bar mu alpha dot beta plus sigma mu alpha alpha dot sigma bar mu alpha dot beta. You see, this is now it depends on alpha and beta indices, so this is has become diagonal 4 by 4 matrix, and this is in fact equal to twice eta mu nu, which is diagonal. It will have alpha and beta indices. Okay, and the same for the other. Another important set of identities are the following. So if we have sigma bar mu alpha dot alpha, remember sigma bar has upper indices, we can certainly lower indices by using epsilon tensors, even in this case, as we did for spinors. And in fact, you can check that this can be written as epsilon alpha beta, epsilon alpha dot beta dot, sigma mu beta beta dot. So if you rise or lower indices, you basically transform sigma bar into sigma, and vice versa, of course, because you have sigma mu alpha alpha dot, this is equal to epsilon alpha dot beta dot, sigma bar mu beta dot beta. Okay, then we have, as you know, a number of properties that we can list for Dirac spinors. We can have Dirac spinors, starting with Dirac spinors, we can extract the Weyl components by using Weyl projectors, or given a Dirac spinor, we can, for instance, impose a reality condition which lead us to Majorana spinors in four dimensions. So let's just see how we can write these conditions in our language. So Weyl projectors, remember that if we consider gamma 5 defined as I gamma 0 gamma 1 gamma 2 gamma 3 in our basis, using our Weyl basis, this is equal to minus the identity 0 0 identity. Therefore, it's kind of trivial that if we define the left projector as 1 minus, 1 is the identity, minus gamma phi over 2, when we apply this projector to a Dirac fermion, what you get is the, let's say, the left component, the chiral component. And of course, if we write P right as 1 plus gamma 5 over 2, when we apply P right to psi, we will get the right component. Okay, where by definition this is psi alpha 0, and this is 0 chi bar alpha dot. Okay, still a few conventions about, for instance, Dirac conjugate. Remember that what is sensible to do when dealing with Dirac fermions is to define not actually the complex conjugate, but what we call the Dirac conjugate, that by definition is that we call psi bar, is given by the Hermitian conjugate of your Dirac spinors times gamma zero. Okay, and if we write psi as we did at the very beginning this way, this is nothing but psi alpha star chi bar alpha dot star times gamma zero, which is this matrix in our basis. Therefore, this is chi bar alpha dot star psi alpha star. Okay, another piece of convention. Now we have to see how we take star of by spinors. You know that the conjugate, the star conjugate, gives the opposite representation. So from a chi bar alpha dot, which is a right spinor, if you take the complex conjugate, you will get a left spinor, so the other Lorentz representation. Therefore, it's just a question of size at this point. So how do we define psi alpha star and chi bar alpha dot star? The conventions that I'm going to use is that is the following. This is equal to minus psi bar alpha dot, and this is equal to minus chi alpha. So basically, you simply get a sign. These conventions can be written in general. This is something that we then use later. This way. Sorry, let's take first. Psi bar alpha dot is equal to I sigma 2 alpha dot alpha psi alpha star, and chi alpha is equal to I sigma 2 alpha alpha dot chi bar alpha dot star. So let's remember these two identities. Okay, therefore, if we go back to the way we define the Dirac conjugate, basically, we simply have here minus chi alpha minus psi bar alpha dot. Okay. Almost done with spinors. the left thing is to consider charge conjugate. Spinors. Okay, so remember that we define, given a Dirac spinor, we define the charge conjugate spinor by definition as the charge conjugate matrix, which is usually chosen to be minus I gamma 0 gamma 2 applied to psi star, which is psi bar transport. Okay, if you take psi bar as being psi star transpose, you get eventually that this is equal to I gamma 2 psi star. And let's see what happens when we use our basis. Okay, I gamma 2 is 0, I sigma 2, I sigma bar 2, 0, applied to psi alpha star chi bar alpha dot star. Okay, so this is equal to I sigma 2 chi bar alpha dot star, and this is I sigma bar 2 applied to psi alpha star. And if we use the rules for complex conjugate that I have written upstairs, you immediately realize that the first line is simply chi alpha and the second line is simply psi alpha. Sorry, that was this sigma 2 bar. Okay, so this is equal to chi alpha psi bar alpha dot. Okay, this is all to get to the point to define Majorana spinors, which indeed what we need to formulate n equal to 1 supersymmetry. So Majorana spinors in four dimensions are defined by the condition that the charge conjugate coincides with the original Dirac spinor. Okay, so in terms of vial components, this is nothing but that psi alpha chi bar alpha dot has to be equal to chi alpha psi bar alpha dot. Which implies, for instance, that chi bar alpha dot is psi bar alpha dot, where psi bar alpha dot is the Dirac conjugate of psi alpha. Therefore, the most general structure for the Majorana spinor, let me call it psi m, is psi alpha psi bar alpha dot. We will always work with this kind of spinors where, as I said before, psi bar alpha dot is I sigma bar 2, oops, alpha dot alpha psi alpha star. Okay, so this is it for our conventions concerning spinors. Let me mention as a last thing, this is not concerning spinor, but concerning tensors in particular. We can use for tensors what we call a double index notation. So let's see tensorial algebra. It is very convenient to use, you know, if we start with the vector, for the vector with components, let's try this way, v0, v1, v2, v3. When we deal with supersymmetry, it is very convenient to use a different notation for vectors, which is the following. So instead of using v mu, we will have components v alpha alpha dot, which by definition, this is still conventions. You can put here any constant factor you wish. Sigma mu alpha alpha dot v mu. Okay, so instead of using v0, v1, v2, and v3, you will use components v1, 1 dot, v1, 2 dot, v2, 1 dot, v2, 2 dot. And for instance, it may be interesting just once in your life to use for, the explicit expression for sigma mu and see how these new components are expressed in terms of the old ones. Okay, so check the explicit relation between v alpha alpha dot and v mu. We can even invert this equation. Let me call this equation number one. What happened? Okay. How do we invert this? What I would like to do now is to express v mu in terms of linear combination of v alpha alpha dot. Okay. It's very easy to invert this relation using the identities that I mentioned before for sigma mu, sigma bar mu. Okay, so if we use sigma mu alpha alpha dot sigma bar mu alpha dot beta, now I put the two indices equal and I sum over alpha dot, this is equal to 4 delta alpha beta. Just take the previous identity and sum over alpha dot. Okay, if we use this identity, we can invert equation 1 and obtain that v mu, with the kind of conventions that I was using, you still have 1 over square root of 2, sigma bar mu alpha dot alpha v alpha alpha dot. Okay. In particular, we can use this kind of notation, the double index notation, for space-time coordinates and for derivatives. Okay. There, it's more convenient to use a little bit different convention with the factor in front. So for space-time coordinates and derivatives, I will use the following conventions. So starting from the usually x mu coordinates, I will define x alpha alpha dot to be 1/2 sigma bar mu, let me put mu down, alpha dot alpha x mu. And you, if you invert using the standard sigma mu identities, you can even write that x mu is equal to 1/2 sigma mu alpha alpha dot x alpha alpha dot. And similarly, I will write that d alpha alpha dot, which means the derivative respect to x alpha alpha dot, is equal to sigma mu alpha alpha dot d mu. Or, if you want to invert it, d mu is equal to sigma bar mu alpha dot alpha d alpha alpha dot. Okay. This set of conventions lead me to the obvious relation that I would like to have, which is the following. If we apply d alpha alpha dot to x beta beta dot, you really get coefficient 1 in front of the obvious delta functions. And another very important identity is the following. If I consider d alpha alpha dot contracted with d beta alpha dot, where you have to sum over alpha dot, this is equal to delta alpha beta box, where box is the usual d mu d mu. In particular, from this identity, you will have that box is 1/2 d alpha alpha dot d alpha alpha dot. This double index notation is certainly very, very convenient when we work in superspace, for instance. Okay, so let me just mention the last two couple of identities that we will often use, or you will often use to perform checks. Useful identities. If you have an antisymmetric sum of the product of two spinors, this expression is antisymmetric under the exchange of alpha and beta, this is equal to epsilon alpha beta times A gamma B gamma. You can check it. And if you have the same thing with dot indices, you will have the same expression. Okay, so this is it for what we call prerequisites about conventions. So now we know how to deal with fermions, which are our conventions to deal with fermions, and now we move to the, let's say, historical, and we'll also review more modern motivations to introduce supersymmetry, and in the meanwhile, I will also define you what we mean with supersymmetry before studying why we want to introduce this new kind of symmetry in relativistic field theories. Okay, so let's see first of all and why, I mean, what we have in mind. This is this part is basically following the historical reasoning that led people to introduce supersymmetry. So let's start, motivations. Okay, so let's start with a very basic observation, which we all well know, Which is the following. We know that our comprehension, our description of the world of elementary particles and fundamental interactions is based on symmetry principles. Okay, so basically we describe the microscopic world by using symmetry principles. So elementary comprehension of elementary particles and their fundamental interactions. Is based on symmetry principles. And we have basically, let's say, two kinds of symmetry principles. One is the set of symmetry principles that allow us to classify particles according to their representations for a given set of groups, okay? So one set of symmetry principles are used to classify particles according to a given set of quantum numbers and we will see how. And the second set of symmetry principles are basically summarizing what we call gauge invariance principle. That allows to introduce, to describe interactions as coming from a gauge invariance principle. Allows to describe fundamental interactions. Okay, let me just remind you in particular the first set of symmetry principles, the ones that allow us to classify particles. So particle classification. How does it work? We know that in classical, even classical theory, one of the main milestones is the Noether theorem that tells us that every time you have a field theory which has an invariant, which is invariant, has a symmetry under a given set of transformations depending on a finite number of parameters, then you have, let's say the number of parameters is n, then you have n conserved currents, okay? So n invariances imply n conserved currents, which means d mu j mu equal to zero, d mu I. And you know that, you know very well that to this conserved current you have n conserved charge, j zero I conserved charge, and you can use the corresponding eigenvalues to classify particles. So in particular, if we impose our relativistic field theory to be Poincaré invariant, this implies that we do have the following conserved currents, momentum, and the Pauli-Lyubansky vector, mu, d mu, w mu equal to zero, where this is defined as epsilon mu nu rho sigma, p nu m rho sigma, where these are Lorentz generators, while p mu are translation generators, so Poincaré generators. And we perfectly know that if we now construct the two Casimir operators for Poincaré algebra, what we have is p square and w square. The first one is featured by eigenvalues that we call m square, and this can be identified with the mass square of particles, whereas w square is featured by s, what we call the spin of particle. Therefore, using m and s, we can classify particles as representations of Poincaré group. We can even have internal groups, internal invariances. Or internal symmetries. And internal symmetries, we have, for instance, isospin. We can have flavor in general. Flavor symmetry as UN, we can have, I don't know, hypercharge, charm, and so on and so forth. They are all U1 invariances. Okay, and your particles can be further featured by the eigenvalues of the Cartan subalgebras of these groups. Okay, we know how to construct, we know this point, which is Poincaré invariance, which is the corresponding algebra. We know how to write down internal transformations of fields corresponding to a given internal group. Therefore, let me just write down what we usually have for Poincaré algebra. So this is p mu equal to zero. Then we have p mu m rho sigma equal to I eta mu rho p sigma minus eta mu sigma p rho. And then we have m mu nu m rho sigma. This is long thing. I eta nu rho m mu sigma minus eta mu sigma m mu rho minus eta mu rho m mu sigma plus eta mu sigma m mu rho. Okay, this is Poincaré algebra, and then we may have an internal symmetry algebra. this is usually associated to a given number of generators. Let me call Ti, given number I going to 1 to n, subject to a non-trivial algebra, which is Ti Tj equal to I F I J K T K, where F are what we call the structure constants of the algebra. And if we want to realize these algebras in our field theory, of course, this algebra has to be realized on fields, and we perfectly know that when we Poincaré generators act on fields, they are given by derivative operators, because these transformations come from space-time coordinate transformations, while Ti transformations are usually of the form phi going to phi prime equal to the exponential of this generator, so a given group element applied to phi. Okay, the first observation that we may have, this is quite sort of trivial observation, but it's better to stress it, is that all these generators are what we call bosonic generators, since they all satisfy ordinary commutation algebra. So they are subject to non-trivial commutation relations, okay? Therefore, it follows that the parameters associated to these transformations are, of course, ordinary numbers, commuting numbers. For instance, these parameters lambda I, these are just numbers, real numbers. Okay, now the question is, which is usually the invariance that we may have concerning a field theory which is made up by a different set of fields, which can be, for instance, a scalar field, but also spinor fields. And the answer is immediately the following. Since, as I said, the parameters associated to these two algebras are ordinary commuting bosonic parameters, this algebra will never have the possibility to make a connection between, for instance, scalar fields and fermionic fields. You will never have transformations which take you from a scalar field to a fermionic field, of course, because you cannot play with any parameter which may adjust the spinorial nature of your spinor in order to give you a transformation which involves scalars. Okay? So the conclusion is that if we have think of the simplest field theory, let's say a theory for scalars, let's just take one scalar and fermion. For instance, the simplest free arc Lagrangian, which is the usual free Lagrangian for scalars and for spinors, when you apply Poincaré transformations or, for instance, phase transformations, under which this is certainly an invariant, the two parts of the action of the Lagrangian, the phi part and the psi part, have to be independently invariant. Okay, so these two parts, let's call L phi and L psi, will be separately invariant under Poincaré and internal symmetry. Since, as I said, there is no way to write down a transformation which mixes the scalar with the fermion. Okay. So since transformations will never mix phi with psi, being the corresponding parameters ordinary commuting numbers. Okay, the question that we ask now is the following. Is this actually the most general situation when we have a field theory which is by definition Poincaré invariant, because we only work with relativistic field theories and internal symmetries? In other words, is there the possibility to have a situation where, for instance, okay, the answer to this question is, of course, for sure, as long as we are dealing with the bosonic algebra, this is not, there is no way out. I mean, the two parts have to be separately invariant, as we said. Now, let's focus on one of the two parts, whatever you want, and the question is whether I can write down something which has a physical meaning, which is invariant under Poincaré symmetry by definition, plus some internal symmetry, which may have a non-trivial commutation relation algebra with Poincaré generators. Okay, so for the time being, we have that this simple algebra, this simple Lagrange is invariant when I apply Poincaré transformation, and it is invariant when I apply phase transformations, and the two kind of transformation, they don't talk to each other, okay? But the question is, can we generalize L in such a way that it becomes invariant under a set of transformations given by generators associated to Poincaré algebra plus possibly other internal generators, but such that we may have non-trivial commutators between the Poincaré generators and the internal generators. Okay? Non-trivial commutation relations between P mu m nu rho and ti. So, since Poincaré is given, the question is whether I can invent sort of internal symmetry generated by some ti, which hopefully do have a non-trivial algebra with Poincaré generators. Okay? The answer is fortunately, no. And this is what is called Coleman-Mandula-Nogo theorem. So the answer is no. And this is Coleman-Mandula theorem. which states the following. If you look at the relativistic field theory, and in particular you look at the S matrix for your theory, which is basically the main object which has a physical meaning, you will immediately realize that this is the way they proved it, and there is a very nice proof by Witten. You immediately realize that if you impose your theory, in particular your S matrix, to be invariant under Poincaré for sure, and this new set of internal generators which do not commute with Poincaré, you necessarily over-constrain your S matrix in such a way that your S matrix will lose analyticity properties. In fact, Witten shows that if you impose, in the most general case, that P mu and mu nu rho do not commute with Ti, if they do not commute, it means that on the right-hand side of the commutators, you will have the appearance of extra generators, but these extra generators have to be an invariance for your S matrix, okay? But this, the imposing this extra invariance, at the end of the day, basically imposes that your S matrix can depend only on angles, scattering angles, which can take only discrete values, and this destroys the analyticity properties of the S matrix, okay? So from a physical point of view, we can never have such a situation. Therefore, the conclusion of Coleman Mandula theorem is that this is no-go theorem. Is that so? Analyticity properties of the relativistic S matrix implies that the most general symmetry group for a physical theory is of the form Poincaré group times some group associated to internal symmetries. Okay? Therefore, this means this is equivalent to say that the internal generators will always commute with the Poincaré generators. In particular, if this is the case, remember how we define the Casimir operators for Poincaré. It follows that then we have that P square Ti is equal to zero. It follows that W mu Ti is equal to zero, then in particular W square Ti has to be equal to zero. Therefore, the fields realizing a representation of the internal group generated by Ti have to have the same mass. Remember P square is what gives mass to your fields. They have to have the same momentum, in particular the same energy, and they have to have the same spin. Okay? So the physical consequences of this no-go theorem is that fields belonging to the same representation representation of the internal group G have to have the same mass, the same momentum, the same spin. Okay, in fact, you know already a very simple example. Think of proton and neutron belonging to the isospin fundamental representation of SU2. Of course, they realize this symmetry only when we assume that they have the same mass. Otherwise, this symmetry is broken. Okay, this is basically a different, in particular the last point, the fact that a multiplet realizing a representation of the internal group is made by fields with the same spin is still what a different way to say what we were already discussing before, when we said, look, the parameters associated to these symmetries, associated to these algebras, are always just numbers, real numbers. Therefore, there is no way using these algebras to realize the transformations that take you from a scalar field, for instance, a field with spin equal to zero, to a fermion field, which means a field with spin equal to 1/2. Sorry, there is no way to modify the spin of your field applying this kind of transformations. And this is what we find here in a different language. Okay. Good, but there is a way out. And at this point, let me just discuss the way out from a pure mathematical point of view. Then we will try to understand why we like this way out from a physical point of view. From a mathematical point of view, there is a way out. There is a way to, you know, avoid the no-go theorem. There is a way to actually introduce some kind of transformation which changes the spin of your fields. And this is to give up commutation rules. Okay, as I'm going to discuss now, there is the possibility to generalize this kind of symmetry groups to what we will call supergroups associated to superalgebras, where we may also have anti-commutation rules among generators, okay? Because this is probably not obvious to you, because one should go through the actual derivation of the no-go theorem, but just believe me if I tell you that no-go theorem, the proof of no-go theorem, is strictly based on the fact that we are dealing with ordinary algebras where we have just commutation relations between generators. Okay, how do we generalize this situation? So basically, what would we like to do, and eventually what is the new kind of transformation that we want to introduce? Let me just make a very let's say little game. Let's call it a little game, just to see from a down-top construction how we can generalize this situation. So let's go back considering a Lagrangian made up by made up by the sum of the kinetic term for a scalar field plus the kinetic term for a spinor field. And let's see whether we can really construct by hands a transformation which maps a scalar into a fermion and a fermion into a scalar. Okay, so let's go back writing the, so let's see how, let me call this introducing Susie by a down top construction, which means that I'm just really trying to play dirty games to see what I can do, okay? Nothing rigorous now, nothing very well classified. Okay, so let's go back to the previous Lagrangian, that is the mu, phi bar, and let me just put in front a factor 1-4, just for, this is just conventions. From the point of view of Poincaré and phase transformations, who cares? The two parts of the Lagrangian are just separately invariant, so we don't care about the relative factor. But this is just to fix conventions for supersymmetry algebra that everybody write down. Okay, so if we, well, you can even want to write it in double spinor notation. So if we go back and use the convention that we have introduced, you can even write the first term this way. And the second term, if you make your gamma mu explicit and you use the Weyl basis, you can prove that can be easily written this way. Okay, so check it. Okay, for sure we have Poincaré invariance, for sure we have phase transformation invariance, okay? So we have Poincaré invariance. We have phase transformations invariance, which means phi going to e to the I alpha phi, alpha real constant, and psi going to e to the I beta psi, still real constant, definitely independent. Okay, but then I can even construct a third set of transformations, and then we will check this leave, indeed, the Lagrangian invariant, which are the following one. Let me introduce new transformation parameters that they are spinor parameters. Let me call them epsilon alpha and epsilon bar alpha dot, which is nothing but epsilon alpha minus epsilon alpha star, according to our conventions on complex conjugate. Okay, these are Weyl spinors, Weyl constant spinors. And let's write the following transformations. The infinitesimal transformation, or well, at this point even final transformation for your scalar, let's put this still is affected by conventions, so let me just put a minus sign for conventions. So this is a transformation for phi, and you see, having introduced a spinorial parameter epsilon alpha, I can certainly play with epsilon and psi in order to construct on the right-hand side something which is a scalar, Lorentz scalar, spin zero. Therefore, this is a certainly meaningful transformation for phi, which has spin zero, okay? If you take the complex conjugate, you will have the corresponding transformations for phi bar. And apply these transformations together with the non-trivial transformation for the spinors that we write this way, minus 2i d alpha alpha dot phi epsilon bar alpha dot and delta psi bar alpha dot, if you take the complex conjugate, minus 2i d alpha alpha dot phi bar epsilon alpha. Again, you see that playing with these new spinorial parameters, we also manage to write on the right-hand side here something which has the correct spinorial index to be a non-trivial transformation for psi. Okay, let's see what happens when we apply these transformations to L. Okay, let's do this. This is one of the few calculations that we do here. So let's see what happens. We have to go back to this expression. So this will be 1/2 d alpha alpha dot delta phi times d alpha alpha dot phi bar plus 1/2 d alpha alpha dot phi d alpha alpha dot delta phi bar. And then we have that was minus I over 2 delta psi alpha d alpha alpha dot psi bar alpha dot minus I over 2 psi alpha d alpha alpha dot delta psi bar alpha dot. Okay, and let's substitute the transformations that we have written over there. Of course, to begin with, you should start with some coefficients to be fixed, but I have already fixed the coefficients in such a way to have things working. Okay, so this is 1/2 d alpha alpha dot applied to minus epsilon beta psi beta d alpha alpha dot phi bar. Then we have plus 1/2 d alpha alpha dot phi times d alpha alpha dot applied to minus psi bar beta dot epsilon bar beta dot. Then we have minus I over 2 times minus 2i d, let's see, this is alpha, this is a variation for alpha down. I need the variation for alpha up. Okay, remember when I move alpha up, minus sign when things are contracted. So when I move this alpha up, nothing changes. I have just to move alpha here up, but then I want to move also alpha dot up in order to have delta alpha dot, and then I will get a minus sign. Okay, therefore this is actually plus 2i d alpha beta dot phi epsilon bar beta dot times d alpha alpha dot psi bar alpha dot minus I over 2. Here, same thing. So psi alpha d alpha alpha dot times 2i d beta alpha dot epsilon beta phi bar epsilon beta. Okay, so let's just order things in a good way. Remember that the Lagrangian has to be invariant up to total derivatives, so I can move derivatives as I wish on different fields. In particular, in the first term, I will integrate d alpha alpha dot on the left on phi bar. Okay? Remember that 1/2 d alpha alpha dot, d alpha alpha dot is box according to our conventions. Therefore, the first term is plus, since I integrate by parts. So I get epsilon beta psi beta box phi bar. Okay. I do the same in the second term. So in this case, I will move the derivative on phi. So I do get plus box phi psi bar beta dot epsilon bar beta dot. Okay. Now, in these two terms, I can remove the factor 2. Then I have I times minus I, which is plus. Then I integrate by parts this on phi. And this this is already, this is what should be there. Okay, so what I get is plus, but then I integrate by parts, it becomes minus epsilon box, be careful, now we have delta alpha beta dot times d alpha alpha dot. Okay, so d alpha beta dot d alpha alpha dot gives me, when I contract alpha, box times delta beta dot alpha dot. Okay. Therefore, what I get is minus box phi times epsilon bar beta dot psi bar beta dot. And if you do the same in the last term, integrate, you apply the derivative and you contract the alpha dot indices, you get minus psi alpha epsilon, oh, let me call beta, beta epsilon beta box phi bar. Okay. Good. Now, these terms all have the same shape, so maybe we are on the right track. In particular, I hope that we can cancel this term with this one, and this term with this one. They, of course, have a different spinorial structure, so they cannot talk to each other. Okay. And what I immediately realized is that if we now assume, so if we assume, this is an assumption, that epsilon, being a spinorial parameter, anti-commutes with all the other spinors, so we assume that epsilon anti-commutes with psi and with psi bar, and the same thing with epsilon bar, and anti-commutes with itself, you will indeed find zero. Okay, so just by hands, playing this simple game, we managed indeed to find a very simple example where we have that the free action of for a theory describing a scalar and a spinor is indeed invariant under a new kind of transformation, which first of all is described, featured by spinorial anti-commuting spinorial parameters, epsilon, and because of this fact, in fact, transforms fields mixing different spin. Okay? Good. This is what we will call supersymmetry. At this point, it's just a game. We have not done anything coherent so far, but let's start from moving from this very tempting transformation to construct a sensible algebra. Algebra of what? Remember that whenever we have a given transformation of your fields, you can think of this transformation as due to the action of a given set of generators applied to the fields. Okay, so we can formally write at this point, so let me call this transformations 3, I guess I never used 3 so far. Okay, so we formally write or think of transformations 3 as due to the action of a set of which kind of generators. Being this generator contracted with the spinorial parameters, I expect the generators to be spinors themselves. Okay? So set of generators that we call Q alpha and Q bar alpha dot, of course associated to epsilon alpha and to epsilon bar alpha dot. And we will write the transformation, for instance, for the scalar, so such that the transformation of the scalar that we have upstairs can be written as I epsilon alpha Q alpha plus epsilon bar alpha dot Q bar alpha dot applied to phi. And the same thing for psi, of course. Okay, for instance, if we match this formal expression with the transformation that we have written, we have that Q bar alpha dot applied to phi is equal to zero. Remember, there is no epsilon bar dependence on phi transformation, whereas Q alpha applied to phi, we should get minus, so I would say this is I psi alpha. So you get minus epsilon alpha psi alpha, which is what we have written from transformations 3, and so on and so forth. Okay, now, once you have the action of generators on your fields, you can construct the algebra, which means what? You can look at, for instance, the commutation of two, let's call supersymmetry transformations, and see what do we get when we commute two transformations. Okay? So let's construct the corresponding algebra. So we perform, let's call a transformation delta 1, and let's apply, for instance, the transformation to phi. So we consider, for instance, a delta 1 transformation, which is given by Q bar alpha dot phi by parameters epsilon 1, and a second supersymmetry transformation corresponding to epsilon 2 parameters. And see what happens when we do consider the commutation between these two transformations. Okay? Okay, and you know how the generators act explicitly on your fields. So, for instance, if you want to make this explicit, this will be by definition this expression, which means if we consider, well, we can first consider the explicit transformations, what we call equation 3. Let me go up, sorry, for a moment. So I will use these explicit transformations, okay, in order to figure out what happens when I commute the two transformations. So this means first that this is delta 1 of what? Minus epsilon 2 alpha psi alpha minus, let me just call it minus 1 exchange with 2. Okay, but this is minus epsilon 2 alpha delta 1 psi alpha minus 1 exchange with 2. So this is minus epsilon 2 alpha times, remember, which is the transformation of psi 1, of psi under one transformation. This is minus 2i d alpha beta dot phi epsilon bar 1 beta dot minus 1 exchange with 2. Okay, so you can you can just order this expression and make the second term explicit. I would like to keep the minus I together with the derivative. So this is minus 2 epsilon 2 alpha epsilon bar 1, let me call it alpha dot, minus 1 exchange with 2, which means minus epsilon 1 alpha epsilon bar 2 alpha dot apply to minus I d alpha alpha dot phi. Okay, but now we are very happy because this operator, depending on what convention you have on Fourier transform, this may have maybe plus ID or minus ID, depends, this is still conventions, but this is what we call the momentum operator. Okay, so this is nothing but P alpha alpha dot. Therefore, what I have, surprise surprise, what I have found is that by commuting two supersymmetry transformations, we end up with a transformation corresponding to Poincaré algebra with a particular parameter that now is given by this expression. Remember that in particular, this is a translation, so the parameters of translation in double index notation are nothing but A alpha alpha dot. What I discover is that the parameter A alpha alpha dot is made up by the juxtaposition of two spinors. Okay, so this is, let me rewrite it as 2 epsilon 1 alpha epsilon, so I get rid of signs. Okay, so this is what we actually find from the transformations that we invented. Okay, on the other hand, we have assumed that the transformations can be written in terms of these generators. Therefore, I can redo the same calculation, computing the commutator delta 1, delta 2, but this time with now, I'm not going to use the explicit transformations, but I'm going to use the delta 1 and delta 2 transformations in terms of Q and Q bar. Okay? So if you do that, so alternatively, using definitions. Let me call them 4. These are 4. Okay. We have that if you compute the same object, so the commutator of two supersymmetry transformation applied to phi, but this time expressed in the transformation in terms of Q and Q bar, if you believe me, let me just write the result. What you get is the following. This is equal to epsilon 1 alpha, epsilon 2 beta, Q alpha, Q beta applied to phi, where the anticommutators arise once you perform delta 1, delta 2, minus delta 2, delta 1. The reason why you get an anticommutator instead of a commutator is because you have assumed that epsilon, being a spinor, will anticommute with every other spinor, okay? Therefore, when you find the order epsilon 1 Q alpha applied to epsilon 2 Q beta, you want to move epsilon 2 in front of Q, you will get a minus. That's the sign that transforms the original commutator into an anticommutator. Okay? Try and check. Okay, so this is the first term. Then you have plus epsilon 1 bar alpha dot, epsilon 2 bar beta dot, Q bar alpha dot, Q bar beta dot, anticommutator applied to phi. And then you have plus epsilon 1 alpha, epsilon bar 2 beta dot, Q alpha, Q bar beta dot. And finally, plus epsilon 1 bar alpha dot, epsilon 2 beta, times Q bar alpha dot Q beta. Everything applied to phi. Okay? Of course, the two expressions have to give you the same result. Therefore, what we learn from this lesson is that since the first line upstairs is only a function of epsilon epsilon bar, whatever you have in this second expression, which is proportional just to epsilon epsilon and epsilon bar and epsilon bar, has to vanish. Okay? So comparing, let's say, 5 and 6, we are led to the following algebra. You will always have Q alpha, Q beta equal to zero. This term does not appear upstairs. Similarly, we will have Q bar alpha, Q bar beta equal to zero. Instead, we like the last two terms, epsilon, epsilon bar, because they have to match the epsilon, epsilon bar terms over there. Therefore, the matching works if we require that Q alpha, Q bar, beta dot is equal to twice I d alpha, beta dot applied to phi. Okay, and according to your conventions on the Fourier transform, this is up to you. This is something that you may call plus or minus, depends on the sign that you choose, P alpha beta dot phi. So what is very interesting is that we have somehow generalized at this point Poincaré group, adding these new fermionic generators, spinorial generators, that have in fact a non-trivial commutation relation among themselves, generating one of the generators of Poincaré algebra. Okay? Moreover, we can complete the picture with the rest of Poincaré generators what we find is that if you now use the Jacobi identity, with Q, Q bar, and P, what you find is that P mu with Q and P mu with Q bar have to be zero. Okay, since I don't know, but I think this is well known, since we are dealing with anti-commutators, you have to use grade, what we call grade Jacobi identities, okay, with both commutators and anti-commutators, depending whether you are commuting or anti-commuting spinorial objects or tensorial objects, okay? So try. You will immediately find this result. Moreover, we have to fix the commutation rules of these new generators with Lorentz generators, mu nu, okay? The way we constructed with these generators is such that if you now consider, so the two generators, Q alpha and Q bar alpha dot are of course vial spinors. And Q bar alpha dot is nothing but the complex conjugate of Q. And they are such that if we put together Q alpha and Q bar alpha dot, this is in fact a Majorana spinor in 4D. Therefore, as such, we expect that under the action of Lorentz generators, they will rotate as usually Dirac spinors, and in particular Majorana spinors, do rotate. Okay? Therefore, what we ask is that the application of a Lorentz generator to Q alpha will produce minus 1/2 sigma mu nu alpha beta Q beta. And if we apply mu nu to Q bar alpha dot, this will be 1/2 sigma bar mu nu alpha dot, Q bar beta dot. Where, as usual, M is the complete Lorentz generator containing both the momentum generator and the spin generator. Okay, so if we put together, let's say, Poincaré, so let's say, conclusion. Poincaré plus this new set of Q alpha, Q bar alpha dot generators with non-trivial let's say anti-commutation rules. Let's see, sorry, I have to go up to see which was the number. No number. So this is what we call 7. And this is what we call 8. Usually 7. And 8 is a closed algebra, in fact. Algebra between quotient marks. We will study which kind of algebra do we actually have. Is a closed algebra, and this is what we call n equal to 1 superalgebra. as I said, so far constructed by hands, simply imposing the invariance of a very simple, trivial field theory. Okay, I think this is a good point to stop, I guess. Okay, so we will reconvene at 3 o'clock for another couple of hours. Do you have questions? Sorry, I didn't mention that whenever you have a question,